some of your predictions. Okay, Gavin?
Gavin should vote for this.
Okay, what makes you think that?
Because we looked at the Hungary flag and then how this goes to be made, made in the...
Okay, Ethan?
He's gonna vote for this.
You think so? Diego?
Because back in the earlier pages, when they were like in the auditorium, like there were like two crowds, one for Thomas and one for Grace. Wyatt was in Thomas's pile and he was looking at Grace.
Interesting. Okay, let's find out. Let's find out. Okay. The Equality State of Wyoming cast its three electoral votes for... Drum roll. Grace Campbell. The gymnasium erupted in loud cheers and a few boos. Miss Barrington approached the podium. With 270 electoral votes, the winner is Grace Campbell.
Yes.
Thomas looked stunned.
Some of the states had like tens and...
It was all different, wasn't it?
Yeah, so that's why she probably won. She got, one of them probably got three.
Thomas looked stunned. Grace hugged Sam. "Why did you do it?" she asked. Sam handed Grace his flag. "Because," he said, "I thought you were the best person for the job."
She's the best girl for the job, instead of the best man.
There you go. The following week, the students in Miss Barrington's class were preparing for their career day presentations. Grace volunteered to go first. She stood at the front of the room and glanced at the poster still hanging on the wall. "My name is Grace Campbell, and when I grow up, I'm going to be President of the United States." This time, everyone believed she would. Okay, listen. Everybody has their group, right?
Yes.
You know your story element.
Yes.
Okay? I want you to talk to your group. Identify your story element in here. Write it down. I will give you about 2 minutes to do that, and then you are going to present it to each other. Okay? Go ahead and start talking with your group. your group needs to be ready to present your element to the class. So you've already written down your element, correct?
Yeah.
And we determined yesterday that all of these elements put together
make
a summary. Very good, Ethan. So you're going to write down what the other elements are presenting as well, okay? Then you've got your summary of Grace for president, all right? Okay, so where's group one? Okay, you guys are going to stand. Your element was what?
The first one.
Okay, go ahead.
So the scene was at the school, and the small moment is when Grace realized that there was no female president, and she was to her.
Okay. They introduced us to Grace by, she did what? She realized what?
She realized that there was no female president.
There's no female president. How does she feel about that? She's mad. Okay. Thank you. Have a seat. Second group. Tell us your element.
Our element is the second one.
Which is what?
The character struggle organization.
Okay. So, which is also the?
Problem.
The problem in the story. Good. So what was the problem?
The problem is Grace, is that Grace lost her own president. At first she thought that it would be easy, but now that she has a new president, it's going to be hard.
Okay. Does everybody agree with that? Yes, kind of?
Kind of.
Okay. Repeat your problem again.
The problem is that Grace wants to run for president. She thought it was going to be easy at first, but now that she has a new companion, it's going to be hard.
Okay, she has, you got it? Okay, you agree? Who agrees? It's a pretty, that was the problem, right? There's no female president. She wants to be elected president.
She thought it was going to be easy, but
it wasn't a person.
Okay, all right.
At first we had like a really big paragraph like this, but then we wanted to like squeeze it into two.
Good. Okay. Thank you. Have a seat. First group three. Okay, what is your element?
It's the excited part.
The most exciting part, okay?
And it was when she thought she was gonna be by herself
Grace thought that Sam was going to vote for the other person, but Sam ended up voting for her.
Okay. We need to back up just a little bit. Think about the most exciting part, but not only just the most exciting part, but where the story started to take a turn. Where did that happen?
Where she wanted to be president when Sam came.
Okay. Whenever there is no female president.
What were they trying to do? What
were
her?
To do an election?
They were doing a. What did we call it?
Election.
Not an election.
Oh, no.
A presidential election.
Think about the posters, the speeches. What is that?
A campaign.
So they're doing the campaign, right? Okay, where does the story start to take a turn? Grace?
When Grace promises everything.
Okay, she made campaign promises, Gavin?
She does what she promised.
She does what she promised? What does Thomas do?
He just works on the latest science project and he plays soccer and then
fish stick tacos every week.
Okay, he quits trying, right? Okay. So he quit trying, and she's still
trying.
She's still working very hard. Okay, thank you.
Okay, we were in room 314, Mrs. Mihalik, fourth grade. Today is the 9th, 9/5/16, started at 105. We were doing ELA. Walked in, the teacher was sitting in front of the room, but with a small group. Or with the group, the entire group. There were 18 students in the classroom. Mm-hmm. We'll talk about engagement in a few minutes, okay? Identified learning was posted. It was obvious that the kids understood what was going on, and we also saw the DAQ. And the DAQ was posted, and again, I think it was very evident that they were going in the direction of what the DAQ was going to be asking. The rigor rate. Let's go around. What did we have here?
Okay. Well, I did remember and understand, but then I also chose to do apply because after the story was read, then the students in the groups had to apply their knowledge and formulate their summary of their element, story element. And then I questioned, I really wasn't sure if it could be evaluate because right at the end, I don't think she did it with every group, but right at the end, the groups were agreeing or disagreeing, and that one group had to defend why they thought it was right. So I wasn't sure if that counted as evaluate or not.
Oh, I would have counted it as evaluate. Even I personally marked it apply, analyze, and would have marked it evaluate also, all three.
I put analyze for the most because what they were doing in breaking up the elements of the story was sequencing. They were separating
exactly.
The elements. And then at the end of that, their whole goal was to summarize the story.
Correct.
Did y'all put it?
I put apply as well.
Yeah.
Apply.
Mm-hmm. So do y'all agree that it would be analyze and evaluate also?
I agree with the analyzing because of
what
they were going to do with putting it back together would take it to the analyze.
Okay.
Very good. On the instructional practices, we started out with whole group instruction, but it rapidly moved into high yield student directed with some summarization. There was some note taking, some collaborative learning, and some student feedback. And the teacher directed, we had the reinforcing effort, individual questions and cues, especially toward the end. She did a good job in providing cues. And there was some formative assessment occurring when she was checking for understanding.
I also had advanced organizers because she had the story.
Exactly.
Yes.
I did too.
That was good.
I also marked verbal discourse on the student directed because of their position in their small groups.
And when they stood up to present, they were doing a very
good job. Good job, Lise. Excellent. On the learning environment, there was no teacherness. Instruction was purposeful. There was effective classroom management. The door window was uncovered. It was very organized. Rules were posted. On visual models, again, you know, this would be something that I think y'all would do a better job than myself. She did use available natural light. The room was clean, and it supported the activity, and the contents or the displays were current. Overall, very good lesson.
I have a question on one of those. Extending the purpose and audience of student work, did you say you put that?
No.
Okay. Did anyone else think that?
The
only reason I thought was because they didn't just do the work and turn it into the teacher, they did the work and presented it to the group. So I put a question mark, but I didn't know if that is a form of extending the audience or it has to even go beyond that.
I think that would be a decision that would need to be made by the campus. The way I interpret it is extending it to the hallway or other classrooms.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
That's my interpretation. But each building can interpret it their own way as long as it's consensus that we all agree that this is extension of the of the purpose and audience of the student work. Okay, let's go back to student engagement. Student engagement. I had one student off task, and I got a feeling that he may be off task quite a bit just because of his wanting to move all the time. And I've got a grandchild like that, so.
Actually, I put that student off task, but it was hard to mark him off task because I know him, and I know he was getting everything that was going on.
So, he even answered out loud at one point. He's like, I knew that was going to happen.
Mm-hmm. Correct. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm going to just say this because this is a place for interpretation. We could have very easily marked all of those authentic or compliant. We really could. Was there the excitement that we would normally see in a very, very authentic? No, but it was, they were all heavily involved. They knew what was going on, and they were really doing a great job of responding to teacher. So I personally would have marked them authentic.
I put authentic.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
I feel compliant, but then I marked that, like, there were like 4 to 5 that I thought were authentic, just because of their engagement with the story, the, you know, like, they were into it.
I judged mine on what I was listening to in the groups, in the small groups.
You could hear more than us, too.
Yeah, so. That's
but I think the ones I thought were just compliant and were kind of, I even thought one girl was off task, but it turned out she was taking notes, yes. And so I misread it at first.
Mm-hmm. Okay. But again, either one of those, because again, there's nothing wrong with compliant. Compliant is something that we're looking for in the classroom. Mm-hmm.
Well, Ms. Malone, why did you consider that compliant?
Because they were all, I'm going to say, doing the same thing, listening. They were all sitting on the carpet. I mean, some of them did say, ooh, or nah, but I didn't know if that was authentic or not. Mm-hmm. So, I'm going to say compliant.
What did you put?
I had compliant.
Okay.
Why did you put that?
I guess it's kind of the same thing, because they're all kind of doing the same thing. Mm-hmm. See, I didn't see them doing, I didn't interpret it as doing the same thing.
Okay.
Because when they moved to their groups, they were all, I thought that was the part that was authentic. I know reading a story is everyday learning for us, but when they moved to those groups and they had to start their, you know, justifying their element, identifying the different components, then I thought it was a little more authentic. But I agree, it could have gone definitely either way.
Either way, and it's not wrong, because the kids were compliant and they were doing a good job. That would be something that the teacher may have may ask, you know, what could I have done to have gotten them to authentic? And we could have very easily said, you know, well, there could have been a little more excitement in the class, or we could have moved up closer and heard more of what was going on within the groups. Okay? But good job, everybody. Good job. Any questions that we need to cover?
As a new teacher, what was that experience like?
I think it's good to see, like, firsthand examples, but also getting to check off, because seeing what the principals and assistant principals see when we walk into, but getting to do it with another teacher who I work with during PLCs and seeing what she's using and just the feedback that I'm hearing from the conversations of listening to y'all too. It makes me reflect back on my teaching and my lessons and how I'm presenting it to the students and what they're doing back for, that they're really understanding it as well.
Very good.
All right, let's start at the top with the teacher location. Where do we see the teacher?
Sitting
in learning zone. Right. And then as far as student engagement, did we all count 18 students?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And what do you have? I have compliant.
I have compliant as well.
I had 14 compliant and 4 authentic.
I thought they were really into what they were doing, and it was a little more in depth because they were defending their choices and stuff. Mm-hmm. So I considered those 4 authentic, but okay.
Very easily could have gone that way. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then as far as identified learning, what objectives were posted, and so was a DAQ.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And then a teacher alignment, the activities, they seem to.
Right.
I know they were doing decimals, but the DAQ was a different question. Couldn't tell if they were.
And they were multiplying. Some of them were multiplying, so they're all doing different things. So.
But with decimals.
But when she was at the table,
were they focused on that?
Yes. And then the others were reinforcement centers. One was decimals, and then the rest were
other skills. Visually on task, I had 2 on task, and I had 2 off task.
That's what I thought too. They were
catch up.
2 were actually working,
2 of them.
Showing work with the coins, and the other 2 were still kind of logging.
That's what I thought.
Good job.
I'll say.
I had to go back 4 times.
And then the DAQ is evident to students. I would say they pretty much all knew they were working with decimals.
Yes.
Okay. And then as far as rigor,
I marked 2 different things. I marked apply, and then I marked evaluate because of the homework conversation.
That's
because
where I was
they're trying
struggling
to
between evaluate and analyze, because I heard them comparing, and I heard them kind of defending, and I didn't know where that one fit.
Mm-hmm. Well, and I wasn't sure because some of them were not. They were just on the understand and apply part, and then you had some groups that were going higher. So it was a mix of everything.
You could actually mark numbers down.
Okay.
How many were in the understand and how many were in the evaluate, especially if you're going to have a conversation with the teacher. Mm-hmm. If the teacher says, you know, well, which of the kids were in the evaluate, and then you could sit down and go, well, these 4 kids, they were in that situation. Mm-hmm. I marked it as understand also. Okay.
Yeah, I had apply and understand. Mm-hmm. Question, so at the rug, would we say that's evaluate or analyze? What do you think they were mostly doing? That's where I was.
So when they were on the carpet, as far as analyze, the only thing I circled was compare, because they weren't comparing their answers.
Or
that was
summarizing.
Waiting for them to keep going on it, and they didn't.
Uh-huh.
So knocked it back down to apply for me.
I thought they were mostly explaining. Like, there wasn't
I could have gone evaluate. I put a question mark. I could have gone that because they were defending their answers.
Yeah, that's why I had a problem.
But I'm not quite sure I would have gone apply, because I agree with you. Mostly they were explaining, and then the other centers, it was just reinforcing prior learning. It was just skills.
Okay.
So I think that's always borderline, and I have a hard time with it because
it's
they're
borderline.
Applying. But
we have to understand that math teachers are always going to want to tell you that they're solving.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, you know, in the applied area. So that they're always going to go, well, they were solving the problem.
Mm-hmm.
But at what level was it at?
All right, and then as far as the high-yield student-directed, what do we have down for that? Well, I said student-to-student feedback, because
mm-hmm.
they definitely have,
mm-hmm.
and the reflection of the carpet,
mm-hmm.
along with verbal discourse.
Verbal discourse.
Verbal
mm-hmm.
discourse.
Mm-hmm.
You can definitely mark collaborative learning
for
what was happening at
the
carpet.
And then the UPS they were using, is that considered note-taking or Cornell notes or using a graphic organizer in the teacher yield?
It would be more like a graphic
organizer. Okay, so would that be in the advanced organizers on your teacher yield?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. Thank you. And any other teacher-directed high yield?
Practice. They were doing some practice.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Table.
Yeah. Some teacher-to-student at the table.
Individual questions.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. She was providing reinforcement to the students that were at the table
mm-hmm.
also.
Right.
Would you consider that feedback too if she's talking to
yes.
them?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Can we go back up to rigor? Because I think we need to mark the technology
level.
And I felt like it was augmentation because they were doing something with that program. It differentiates for the students, which you can't do without the technology.
Okay.
I circled functional improvement.
Mm-hmm.
I had an institution, but that kicked it up just enough.
Mm-hmm. And then any low yield, that worksheet would be considered.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
And then the learning environment. What do we notice?
Instruction was good.
Effective classroom management was really well.
But on my notes, I would have written that four students were involved with technology.
Mm-hmm.
That's
yeah.
what I would have written down in the notes that way. Because it's, if we just check off technology, it seems like it's the whole group. Sorry. Mm-hmm. In reality, it was just four students.
The only thing I didn't mark under environment was extending the purpose of the audience.
Mm-hmm. That's what I didn't do.
Right. Good job, Sarah. Very good. Just got it down pat last year.
I just followed what you did last year.
Good. With DataWalks, what we're trying to do is we're trying to create a new culture. We're trying to get away from the culture of teachers in isolation and develop a culture of collaboration in the classroom. And it's about opening the classrooms to everybody, to teachers, administrators, basically anybody that has interest in improving learning in our schools are welcome into the classrooms. What DataWalks do for everybody is the fact that they give us specific criterion to look for when we go into classrooms. We look at student engagement, we look at objectives, we look at rigor rate, and then we really look at what strategies are being utilized, knowing that research-based strategies is the direction that we want to go if we're going to improve instruction in Castleberry ISD. But we look at the entire component when we go into a classroom, that 5 to 10 minute period that we quickly go in, we can catch a lot of what I said very quickly and very effectively, providing solid data to our teachers. And again, I commend Castleberry ISD for being very heavily involved with the DataWalk process, and I hope they continue it for their professional learning communities. Thank you.
Hi, I'm April Scott. I am the campus academic leader at Joy James Elementary, and I just wanted to talk a little bit about how data walks are really improving our PLC process here at Joy James. From a planning perspective, the teachers have been able to use the data they get from their data walk analysis to really hone in on their lessons. Specifically, we mark the rigor at which their lesson is when we walk in for the data walks. So they get a report that shows them what percentage of the time they're at remember, understand, apply, analyze. So that leads to some really authentic conversations about how do we get out of that rut of just remember and understand? How do we push our kids to a higher level? There are other aspects that have been great for teachers to look at as well. We mark the level of student discourse in the classroom. We want the students using that academic vocabulary, justifying their answers, being able to connect their learning to other areas, to prior learning, and so they get that feedback as well as far as how their students are responding to answers that they're giving throughout the class. Another area that we are really trying to grow in is our technology usage. That's also marked on the data walk analysis. Gives our teachers a chance to look, are we on the SAMR model, are we at substitution? Are we just using technology for those basic things, or is there a way that we can up it so that we get more into that modification and redefinition part of the SAMR model? The conversations in the PLCs then take on a whole different feel, because it's all about how can we make everything that we do for students better? How can we improve? It really lends itself to that growth model of we can always improve our practice. We can always be looking at fine-tuning things as far as the way we present our lessons and the way we engage our students.